So we start with chapter 1. I'll give you a few definitions. Okay.
Thank you.
So we'll just look at what are the controls. Control system is an arrangement of physical components connected or related in such a manner as to command, direct, or regulate itself or another system. Okay. So this arrangement of physical components connected or related, that is how you define a system itself. Something which can command, direct, or regulate itself or another system, that is what is a control system. That is what is makes it a control system. Okay. Then we look at a couple of other definitions. We discussed this briefly. An open loop control system is one in which the control system is independent of the output. What is the example we looked at?
Time.
What is an example of an open loop control system?
Oh, the toaster.
Toaster.
What is that? Of the what?
Of the output.
Oh, output.
All slash. Here, an example would be, let's say, an autopilot system. Now think about, try to distinguish what is a system and a control system. Okay?
You say what?
Distinguish, try to distinguish between a system and a control system. So if in the case of a toaster, toaster is a control system, right?
Mm-hmm.
What would be an equivalent system?
Get the question.
Like a microwave?
Microwave is also a control system.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
So what example for
a washing machine?
Washing machine is also a control system.
Yeah, you're saying how much time
you have,
it's not saying that it has to be
a bag,
color.
And you're heating the
so
bread by yourself. You understand?
Hmm?
Yeah.
Think about a pan and the oven range, and you're heating the stuff by yourself. You're not, nothing is controlling. You're just switched on the system. The pan is on that, and then you're toasting the bread. You are controlling how the bread is toasted, right? That would be just a system. That is not a control system.
But you're controlling.
So when human element is involved,
oh, okay.
There is
not control.
So when the bread is being toasted in the toaster, there's no human element, right? You just pop it and then you move away.
Okay.
Automatic. Washing also. What is an automate for a washing machine?
When it put the time on, go off when it wants to.
So you're just washing it yourself, then that is a system. Okay? You're soaking, you're washing yourself. Okay. Or you had, let's say, something on those lines. Okay. Think about an autopilot. What is the system here, if not for autopilot?
The pilot.
What is the system in this autopilot?
Oh, in the autopilot.
Here we talked about closed loop control, right?
Mm.
So this you understand the open loop aspect of it. When you're doing the autopilot, the system itself is the aircraft.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Autopilot is really a small component of the aircraft.
Mm-hmm.
And it is, so you look at it in the sense that regulate itself or another system. Can an aircraft exist without
autopilot?
Without an autopilot?
Yes.
Yes. Right? So here autopilot is, you can take an aircraft, existing aircraft, and make it an autopilot and bring in that control system. Autopilot itself would be the
control system.
Okay.
Mm.
And then we're going to look at what is important for control, closed loop control is feedback. Okay? So feedback. That property so feedback, do we have any feedback for the open loop system?
No.
There's no feedback, right?
Mm-hmm.
So feedback is strictly associated with closed loop control. So feedback is that property of a closed loop system, which permits output to be compared to the And when you have feedback, have increased accuracy. Tendency towards oscillation. Reduce sensitivity.
Can you explain the second line?
Sure. So now, just look at this. As a result of feedback, you're going to have increased accuracy, right? Is that, that's understandable, right? If you had a toaster which could figure out or which could sense how well the bread is toasted, then it would not, the action would not be purely based on time. It would look at the feedback and need be, it would keep the toasting for a longer time. If need not, then it would just pop out the bread. Tendency towards oscillation. Now think about an autopilot or an aircraft. If you're required to maintain a certain cruise at a certain altitude, how will you get there?
How would you get there? You would go up and up. What do you mean? How would you get there?
So you're going to...
Well, something's going to tell you that you're not high enough, so you're going to keep increasing.
Right. So you go, you keep going. Let's say, think about going on the highway, okay?
Mm-hmm.
Going on the highway from within the city. You're going to get on the ramp. You're going to speed up.
Right.
And if the speed limit is about 70 miles an hour, when you're speeding... You'll probably go at maybe 72, 73, right?
90.
And then maybe come down to 70. So you have that oscillating effect. You're not going to reach there with... more often than not, there's a tendency that you're going to go above and come back. You understand? That is the oscillation which we talk about. And reduced sensitivity of the ratio of output to input to variation in system parameters. Let's go back to, let's say, let's go back to the toaster again. Sensitivity of the ratio of output to input variations in system parameters.
But this only works for a closed loop, so how are we going to use a toaster?
Let's look at the closed loop system, okay?
Mm-hmm.
What are system parameters, and do these parameters change?
Yeah, depends on...
Over time, do system parameters change?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because if you're doing autopilot...
Give me an example.
If you're doing autopilot, mm-hmm. you may want to go 35,000 feet.
That is the desired output. What the system parameters? The system parameters in the sense, its mass, its, let's say, Let's look at a rocket and let's look at an aircraft. Okay. Does the mass of the rocket change significantly?
Yes. Yes. So it's gone up.
Right. Does the mass of the aircraft change significantly?
Yeah.
Not a whole lot, right?
Not
at the rate of the rocket, right? So if you look at the system parameter, is the mass of the rocket. Okay. If you're looking at mass of the rocket will change significantly, and the mass of the aircraft will not change significantly.
What's another example? Because I get you.
Think about you're heating something. Okay. Will the electricity required remain the same?
Okay, kind of same.
No, it might say more.
If you're heating something, okay, and you're going to use a coil to heat, let's say, water. Okay. How are you going to heat the water? You're going to just pass electricity through that coil, right? And then that coil is going to heat up. Is it going to draw the same amount of current as the coil heats up? What happens if the coil heats up?
It heats to a certain point, then it cools down.
What I'm trying to get at is a system parameter of the coil is its resistance. Okay, the higher, because of the resistance, the coil is going to start heating up. Does the resistance remain the same?
Are you trying to get to a certain temperature, the resistance will be the same no matter what, right?
No. Resistance is proportional to? Resistance is proportional to temperature. If you increase the temperature, the resistance of that coil increases. Okay? And if resistance increases, what happens?
The temperature increases.
Because your supplied voltage is the same. You remember this law? V is equal to I. This is Ohm's law. This is the current required to heat up. Okay. If this resistance increases, this voltage is the same. So what happens to the current?
Smaller.
It has to get smaller, okay, to keep the voltage the same. So this, it will not be generating as much power. What is power? How do you define power?
What?
How do you define? VI. Right? The power output of that coil, which is a system parameter, is not going to be the same. It's not going to be outputting the same power. So as the resistance increases, this power will reduce. Make sense? So when you have another way of looking at it is, look at an autopilot, okay? Or look at something like a self-driving car. What are the parameters of a self-driving car? Or let's say you're trying to follow a line, right?
The auto parameter, if it sees something, it stops.
So if something changes, let's say if you're driving a self-driving car, it has to accelerate, right?
Mm-hmm.
And acceleration, it has to to accelerate, it has to apply thrust, or it has to produce thrust.
Mm-hmm.
Is that thrust going to be the same regardless of how many passengers are in the car?
It's not going to be the same.
It's not going to be changed. It's the same, right?
Mm-hmm.
It's going to change. Now, can it, if it has a feedback, okay, to produce the same speed, it needs to change the thrust, right? Now, if you do it a very direct way, what you're going to do is, every time you have to calculate the amount of people in there, and then accordingly produce the thrust.
Mm-hmm.
But if you have a feedback, for example, if you have a feedback of the speed, regardless of how many people are in there, it'll try to maintain that. It'll try to adjust this thrust such that it'll maintain a particular speed, because the speed is being fed back, constantly fed back. Your cruise control, what happens in a cruise control?
It stays at whatever speed.
Speed is set at it. So regardless of whether you're going up mm-hmm. or down, that is the system parameter.
Mm-hmm.
Regardless of system parameter, the sensitivity is not compromised. Okay, that is the usefulness of feedback. And reduced effect of disturbance. Are there disturbances when you're flying an aircraft?
Yes.
So what do you do with the disturbance? What is the system designed to do?
Correct.
You just correct, or you have to ignore the disturbance. Okay. So when you have a feedback, you know where you're going and you know how off you are. So you're actuating. Let's say you're walking this way. Okay. If you have your system knows that you have to walk this way. There's a big gust of wind flowing, and you start shaking. Your system will adjust to that. Okay. Only if you have a feedback. What is your feedback? If I ask you to go in a straight line, okay?
Yeah.
And I close your eyes. Do you have a feedback?
No, because you cannot see.
Right.
And thus, you can't compare to.
Right. So you'll try to go in a straight line. Let's say there is disturbance. Now, there is no feedback through your eyes. Now, you cannot go in a straight line. You understand? So, feedback helps you reduce the effect of external disturbance. And as definitions, we'll finally look at analog and digital So when we look at analog and digital control system, let's look at an analog signal. Do you understand analog signals?
Mm-mm.
What is analog? Do you see analog signals here?
Yeah, on a clock. Somewhere. Oh, never mind. Did they have a clock?
Analog?
Yeah.
These lights? Is analog signals going to these lights?
No, right?
Analog signals going.
So
signal
it makes
is
it analog.
Continuous. So signal is? Continuous, yes.
The fan
is also analog, yes.
Your keyboard.
So why would you prefer analog?
Keyboard is not analog.
So why would you prefer analog over digital system?
Who said that?
No, I'm saying why would? No, I'm saying like what? Why, I'm saying thank you, thank you, thank you. Appreciate it.
We'll get to that. So analog signal. If I first understand what an analog signal is, okay. What kind of TV is that?
Digital.
Have you seen analog TVs?
Yeah.
Those CRT TVs?
The
not the knob. The knob itself does not make it analog or digital. What makes?
The
tubes.
The
yeah,
tubes. Okay, so here what you see is, this is made out of? These are pixels on this, right?
Mm-hmm.
Small, 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 small pixels. So each pixel is either lit or not lit, right? But what happens with the analog signal? And also, you see those big CRTs. You know what a CRT is? CRT monitors, I'm sure you have used. Cathode ray tubes.
Mm-hmm.
When your signal is projected onto a screen, a reverse signal is projected onto a screen, and we see that. So that, everywhere, that signal is one signal. Okay. For example, think about light. Okay. Electricity, when it flows, is it analog or digital?
Analog.
It's analog, right? If I were to make this digital, what would happen if I made this digital?
It will blink.
It will blink, exactly.
Why? I don't understand that.
So that's here,
if
this one
digital,
too, it is actually blinking. Do you realize that? You don't realize that, right?
Because it's going to affect the face.
It is, the brain is blinking at such a high frequency that our eyes don't realize that. Okay? Even in TV, CRT TV, the screen is constantly refreshed. If the frequency does not, try to record a CRT TV. Try to record a video of a CRT. It'll do that. Because the frequencies don't match. Only if the frequencies match, you'll see a clean screen. That thing is not, our eyes cannot detect it, okay? So when something is refreshing, then it is a digital signal. Here it is a digital signal because it is refreshing at a really high rate, okay? But this is an analog signal because it's not refreshing. It's just continuously being supplied, okay? If you made this, like, blink, if you have Christmas lights, then only those are digital.
Mm-hmm.
Those are blinking. And then you have digital signals. Now relate what is, you know what a signal, digital signal and analog signal is. So analog signal is essentially, the signal is actuated or it gets sent at discrete times, okay? Now think about what an analog control system is. What is an analog control system? Right, continuous supply of signal. For example, your air conditioning is a analog system. Okay, your autopilot is, it's actually digital. The signal itself is sent digitally, but it is sampled at such a high frequency that you don't realize it.
So what is the discrete difference between the two?
Analog is continuous. If you, for example, if you look at differentiation, you can perform differentiation only on
analog.
So what you do is, if you look at this signal, right?
Mm-hmm.
That's it.
Continuous.
Continuous analog signal. If you read the signal here, 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 and then connect it,
then that'll be digital.
That's discrete. So you're reading or you're actuating at discrete times. Okay. So you have to understand this analog and digital control system, or at overall, try to get a feel for what analog and digital systems are. Okay. Most of the systems you see today are
digital
systems.
So air conditioning is analog, doesn't it turn off?
It is. When it operates, the control system itself is digital. Yes. So what happens is the control system is continuously checking at every time instance. It is checking the temperature, and then the temperature reaches. It will. The checking of the temperature is discrete. So if you're looking at a lot of the elevators, when they were designed initially, they were analog elevators.
How?
There was no controls, or there was no digital systems. Elevators were designed way back.
Okay.
It was all?
Yeah. You're talking about the little, yeah.
Okay. Even the automatic elevators were all analog elevators. There was, the mechanisms were such that when it hit something, it just stopped.
So, for example, no matter how outside, how it, even if you, it always starts at the ground floor, and then it goes to whatever floor, and then it will just come right back down instead of staying at that floor.
Right.
So that'd be
elevators.
So what is happening is, in these elevators, there are relays. Okay. You know what relays are?
Yeah.
Relays are essentially sensors. Okay. So if it touches a relay, that signal goes to the computer in that elevator, and the elevator, then the computer is connected to the motor which drives it up and down, and the computer will stop the motor. You understand? So there was no computer in older elevators. It had to, the relay had to automatically switch off the motor. Get it? We just finished this class with some block diagrams, basics. We're going to use a lot of these block diagrams to describe our control system, okay? This a little bit in the previous class. So what we have is, we'll use something like this. This is our output or response. Let me put this in. This is the signal. This is a system. This is again a signal, and then you have the summation block like this. Okay. Here, if this is A, B, and C. Depending on what signs I use, A minus B is equal to C. Okay. And here the way this, you have to read this is, you have a system, a signal goes into the signal into the system, and a signal comes out of the system. Okay. Now, let's look at an example here. Pay attention here a little bit. We have used these two to do this block diagram, just use represent a typical control system. Okay. Now think about let's say think about yourself here. The plant or process is you. Okay? Actuators are
joints.
Your limbs, right? Your joints, right? Your legs, your arms. Control is
the whole body. The heart. The brain.
The brain. Okay, and these are your sensory organs. Okay, the whole point of is to control the plant or process. What do limbs actuators do?
Move.
Actuators are essentially facilitating your yourself, right? They're helping you move. They're helping you pick up stuff. Correct? What is being fed back? What kind of feedback do you get to your brain?
It is working appropriately.
All your senses, right? What you hear, what you smell. So if you're going to a certain place, right? First, you're going to see whether you're going to that place. You're going to try and take the shortest route. On that shortest route, if you hear something, you know, if, let's say you hear the voice of a snake, or hear some wild animal on that path, will you go there?
No.
You'll take the other path. Okay. So that is the feedback element. Now, the hearing. Has it got anything to do with walking?
No.
It doesn't, right? So the hearing gets converted into something which is... The output is what?
Of hearing?
The output. What is the output here? Let's say your goal is to walk from A point A to point B.
What you hear does matter.
Huh?
What you hear does matter.
What is the output?
Of walking?
Getting to point B.
Yeah. Point getting from point A to point B, your output would be position, right? When you do this and I want to go from that point to that point, at every step, I'm looking at my position, right? Incremental position. What is sensing position? Eyes are sensing position, right? So is eye really sensing the position? It's seeing something, and that seeing something is converted to a position. So those are the feedback elements. What is your input? Is there a direct relationship between what you're seeing and what is being input?
So the input would be like the desire.
You're trying to get to a certain spot. That's the input, right?
But the input is actually your muscular motion, right?
Oh, move the eyes.
Eyes is really sight. So can you take the difference of muscular motion and sight?
Yeah.
No.
You cannot. But can you take... what I'm trying to get to is the position information, what eye is seeing...
Does not matter if you walk in.
Is converted into something which is comparable to the input. You see that? It gets transduced. What is this input in a typical autopilot system? What are you inputting?
You're trying to get a certain altitude, weather.
What are you inputting here? Let's start with here. So this is your plane, okay? The plant or process. What is the what are actuators in a this thing?
In a plane? The wing.
Elevators and the ailerons, okay? So when you elevator angles and elevator, this are the actuator signals, right? What is the output? What is the output?
They're telling you how fast you're going,
how high, all those information, right? So based on that, what is the control?
This the control is what you're trying to get to.
This is the computer. The flight computer. Okay. So the computer, all this information, the output is fed. What kind of output is fed? Fed back. The position is fed back. Right. The
speed
is fed back.
The weather
altitude
maybe.
Is fed back. All those are fed back. But if you look at the input is, the reference input is what? The reference input is what?
What you put in is what your goals were, how high you wanted to be.
Yes. So
what type of speed
you want to be. How high you want to be, what position. So the reference input, for example, for the position, it keeps changing. Right? Because you have already set a waypoint, how you want to go there. So that reference input for the position keeps changing. Now the position, you can directly cancel off. Got it? The other reference input is, let's say, altitude, right? You can just simply cancel off. You can measure the What does an altimeter really measure?
Pressure.
It measures pressure. That pressure is converted to?
The feedback
altitude here. Yeah. It's transduced to an altitude. So you cannot really take the difference of pressure and altitude, right? So that altitude, the actual altitude is measured as a pressure. It gets converted to altitude. And the reference altitude and the actual altitude. The reference is the desired altitude. And this is the actual altitude. If the difference is zero, then what happens?
Then you're at what you want to do.
Then you don't really necessarily need to control anything. Hmm. Okay, if you're at the desired altitude, what happens is the only actuators which are working are, what are the other actuators apart from ailerons and elevators?
The
flaps. The thrusters. There's a thrust as well, right? Okay. You cannot just, the elevators and ailerons will control the orientation, but you have to keep thrusting as well. That is the other actuator. So when you have reached the desired altitude, your actuators, your ailerons and elevators are not working. Your only thing is that at that moment only the thrusters are. Okay. Speed wise, again the thrusters. Can you measure speed? Is there a sensor to measure speed? You cannot actually measure speed. You can measure position, you can measure acceleration. So you have to either measure position and take the derivative of that to figure out the speed. Or you measure acceleration and you integrate. Get that is also again. Okay. We'll stop here and continue.